digging on Mars with the Perseverance rover in those little titanium tubes that we intend to go back and pick up, digging in a dry lake bed near the mouth of a river. Now we're going up to the top of the cliff where the scientists feel that there could be the best examples of, if there were life there millions of years ago. Whether we're dealing with Perseverance or the James Webb Space Telescope, which searches for exoplanets with signs of habitability, we are looking for signs of life, past and present. And it's in our DNA to explore and to ask why things are the way they are. In June of last year, NASA commissioned an independent study team to examine unidentified anomalous phenomena. We did so with a few goals in mind. First, to examine how NASA can use our expertise and instruments to study UAP from a scientific perspective. Second, shift the conversation about UAP from sensationalism to science, and to make sure that whatever we find or whatever we recommend, to make sure that information is shared transparently around the world. There's a global fascination with UAP. On my travels, one of the first questions I often get is about these sightings. And much of that fascination is due to the unknown nature of it. Think about it. Most UAP sightings result in very limited data. That makes it even more difficult to draw scientific conclusions about the nature of UAP. And so this independent study team brought together some of the world's leading scientists, data, and artificial intelligence experts, aerospace safety specialists, all with a specific charge from me, which is to tell how to apply the full focus of science and data to UAP. And this is the first time that NASA has taken concrete action to seriously look into UAP. And this independent study team was just that, independent. Now, NASA has a statutory authority to look for life in the universe. And when you think of the universe, and especially what we have learned from the James Webb Space Telescope, how vast that it is. We knew before, and it was a NASA scientist, Dr. John Mather, who got the Nobel that determined that the universe was 13.8 billion years old. And over the years, particularly accelerated in the last century, we have an understanding that, of course, ours is not the only galaxy. And there are billions and billions of galaxies, and each of those galaxies, including our own, have billions and billions of stars. And with the James Webb looking at the exoplanets, we are now beginning to discover, and somewhere out there, we will discover another medium-sized stony planet around a medium-sized sun or star at just the right distance, not too far, not too close, with a tilt in its axis that rotates, that has carbon, that will have a habitable atmosphere. If you ask me, do I believe there's life in a universe that is so vast that it's hard for me to comprehend how big it is? My personal answer is yes. But I asked some of our scientists. As a matter of fact, the Washington Post editorial board asked us to come down to the question, what is the mathematical probability that there is life out there in the universe? And if you calculate in billions of stars, in billions of galaxies, that there's replicated what I just said, another stony planet. The answer was, what's the likelihood? At least a trillion. That's from our scientist. So we start this without any preconceived notions, but understanding that we're in a world of discovery. And we, NASA, have taken for the first time concrete action to seriously look into UAP. And this independent study team is exactly that. It's independent. They work to develop recommendations about how NASA could better examine them from a scientific perspective. And the top takeaway from the study is that there is a lot more to learn. The NASA independent study team did not find any evidence that UAP have an extraterrestrial origin. But we don't know what these UAP are. That's why I'm announcing that NASA has appointed a NASA director of UAP research. They are being tasked with developing and overseeing the implementation of NASA's vision for UAP research. We will use NASA's expertise to work with other agencies to analyze UAP. We will use AI and machine learning to search the skies for anomalies, as we have been searching the heavens and will continue to search the heavens for habitability. And NASA will do this transparently. So while today is a significant step for NASA, it's certainly not our final step. And we're going to share more with you, and I want to introduce you to Dr. Nikki Fox, who is the head of our Science Mission Directorate. Nikki.
Good morning, and thank you so much, Administrator Nelson. It's always tough to follow Bill. He's such a great speaker. But I want to thank the independent study team for their amazing service on the study and for their continued contributions towards the advancement of our nation's understanding of unidentified anomalous phenomena. UAP, as Bill just eloquently said, UAP are one of our planet's greatest mysteries, and it's really due to the limited number of high-quality data that surrounds such incidents and often renders them unidentifiable. While there are numerous eyewitness accounts and visuals associated with UAP, they're not consistent, they're not detailed, and they're not curated observations that can be used to make definitive scientific conclusions about the nature and the origin of UAP. The language of scientists is data, and data points towards a scientific conclusion to what the nature and the origin of UAP could be. That leads us to why we're here today. The independent study team's report is now public, and it can be found at science.nasa.gov/UAP. While NASA is still working to evaluate the report and to assess the independent study team's findings and recommendations, NASA is committed to immediately contributing to the federal government's unified UAP effort, and as you heard, we have appointed a director of UAP research. In their role, they will centralize communications, resources, and data analytical capabilities across the federal government to establish a robust database for the evaluation of any future data. Additionally, our Director of UAP Research will also leverage NASA's expertise in artificial intelligence, machine learning, and space-based observation tools that will support and enhance the broader government initiative into UAP. They will serve as NASA's point of contact for government entities, but especially for the All Domain Anomaly Resolution Office, or ARRO. And this will ensure our coordinated efforts and effective communication channels. Beyond our director of UAP research, NASA will also advance citizen reporting by working with the public and commercial pilots to collect a broader set of data to add to the vast data repositories to not only contribute to a broader, more reliable data set for future UAP incidents, but to also contribute to the destigmatization of the important study of UAPs. And with that, it is my great pleasure to hand over to Dr. Dan Evans, who is the NASA official responsible for supporting this amazing study.
Good morning. I'd like to begin by expressing my sincere thanks to NASA Administrator Bill Nelson for directing this study. We at NASA believe that understanding UAP is vital for several reasons. First and foremost, it provides an opportunity for us to expand our understanding of the world around us. At NASA, we are committed to charting the uncharted, so this work aligns with who we are. Secondly, this study aims to enhance situational awareness. The presence of UAP raises serious concerns about the safety of our skies. And it's this nation's obligation to determine whether these phenomena pose any potential risks to airspace safety. Let's not forget that the first A in NASA is aeronautics. So by understanding the nature of UAP, we can ensure that our skies remain a safe space for all. Administrator Nelson directed us to put together an independent and external team of world-leading experts to produce a report containing a roadmap with a series of recommendations that describe how NASA could best help in the cross-government response to UAP. Months of meticulous fact-finding, cross-disciplinary collaboration, and scientific rigor gave the team insights that will greatly enhance our nation's understanding of UAP going forward. The team's report, now available on NASA's website, stands as a testament to NASA's and the team's commitment to transparency, to the power of science, and to the unwavering quest for knowledge. We at NASA believe that studying UAP represents an exciting step forward in our journey to uncover the mysteries of the world around us. By embracing a scientific lens, we have ensured that our work is evidence-based and data-driven. And by valuing transparency and openness, we have aimed to foster trust and collaboration with the public. I'd like to conclude by extending my deepest gratitude to the team for their incredible dedication and service. Their efforts have been instrumental, and I truly appreciate the expertise and commitment that each of them have brought to this endeavor. And with that, I'll pass over to Dr. David Spergel, who chaired our study.
Well, first and foremost, I'd like to extend our sincere gratitude to the NASA Administrator for entrusting us with this pivotal study. Your faith in our capabilities has been a driving force behind the panel's approach. The panel's comprehensive study into unidentified anomalous phenomena, or UAP, has led to several crucial findings, and I'd like to elucidate on our methodology and those findings this morning. We began by rigorously assessing the current state of UAP data. Our goal was not to repeat the work of the Arrow, but to understand the nature of the reports. Our goal was to produce a roadmap for NASA to contribute to the understanding of the nature of UAP events. We looked at NASA's assets. While they provide a comprehensive picture of the ocean, the Earth's surface and atmosphere for studying our evolving planet, they typically do not have the resolution needed for UAP events. However, by providing data on environmental conditions, they can complement other data on UAP. The current approach to UAP data collection has led to a limited sample of events and limited data. Stigma has limited reporting by pilots, both civilian and military, so we know there's missing data. For its analysis in other areas, NASA always takes a scientific approach of systematic data collection that involves calibrating instruments, multiple measurements, and ensuring sensor metadata. Most UAP events lack this quality of data. One of NASA's contribution to the broader governmental effort to bring these methodologies to create a data set is to bring these methodologies to create a data set that's both reliable and extensive. And once we have a large sample of well-characterized events, AI and ML tools, which are proving to be powerful in so many other applications, will likely prove helpful in identifying interesting anomalies. It is essential to clarify, based on our current findings and methodology, that we find no evidence to suggest that UAP are extraterrestrial in origin. Our focus is on understanding the phenomenon, however, regardless of the source. And previous work from the Arrow has shown that most events are explainable as planes, balloons, drones, weather phenomenon, and instrument features. And in any search for interesting anomalies, the first step is to eliminate the chaff of conventional events before moving on to identify novel phenomena. In this, the public's role cannot be overstated. The panel envisioned a framework that leverages crowdsourcing, possibly via smartphone applications, to capture a broader spectrum of data, ensuring more eyes and ears on the ground. Lastly, we delved into the safety concerns UAP present within U.S. airspace. By integrating UAP collection within our current aviation reporting system, the panel believes we can provide insights into potential safety risks. NASA can reduce the stigma associated with pilots reporting anomalies, and fundamentally, by studying events we don't understand, we advance our understanding. So in conclusion, with a rigorous methodology, collaborative efforts, public engagement, NASA can be a key player in the whole of government approach to understanding UAP. Thank you.
Thank you so much to all of our speakers. We will start taking questions. For those in the room, we have a microphone over here that we would ask you to speak into. We will also be alternating with questions from those on the phone line. For those of you who are in the phone line, please press *1 to get onto the queue. We will try to answer as many as we can today. We'll see how it goes. Please, sir.
Thank you very much. This is directed to Mr. Nelson. Thank you for being here. Two quick questions. One is, how can we make the determination of what something isn't when we don't know what it is? And B, after a careful review of the data, if it's determined that some, underline the word some 10 times, UFOs or UAP originate from a non-human intelligence, what's the plan to disclose that to the public?
And can you identify yourself, please?
James Fox.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, and what outlet?
Independent Media. Thank you.
Well, let me repeat.
It's on.
Let me repeat what I said. I think it's important that you hear this word for word. The NASA independent study team did not find any evidence that UAP have an extraterrestrial origin. but we don't know what these UAP are. The mission of NASA is to find out the unknown. I've said several times in my comments here today that we, NASA, deal openly and we will be transparent on this. And we're trying to address the question of there's so much concern that there's something locked up, classified, and that the American government is not being open. Well, we are the American government, and we are open, and we're going to be open about this. We don't, again, I'm going to repeat that statement, but we don't know what these UAP are, but we're going to try to find out.
Thank you very much. And is there a plan in place if it is determined that some of them represent or originate from a non-human intelligence to tell the public? Is there a plan, or?
If we are what I said we intend to be, which is transparent, you bet your boots, we will say that. And I've tried to set the table for you by telling you what I personally believe in a universe that is so vast that could there be a replication of life on Earth elsewhere in another solar system that is so big? Of course I believe that. The distances, it would have to be a very advanced civilization. The distances, you know, light years, hundreds of light years, billions of light years. But whatever we find, we're going to tell you.
Thank you very much.
Great. And we'll move on to the next question. Please do identify yourself.
Thanks. This is Joey Roulette from Reuters. Question for Bill Nelson or any of the other panelists. So you've appointed a director of UAP research. Have you named someone to that role? And what kind of investment are you considering making in this? Is this going to be a new program office? Have you thought of funding figures, et cetera? Thanks.
Yes, we have. We've already appointed the person. They've been working there for a while now, like during the study, to help be a point of contact. And any budget discussions, of course, are part of a very intricate federal budget request, and so they're not something that we discuss openly. But we will certainly look at what resources need to be allocated.
Can you name the official who's in
We will role? Not give his name out, no.
Thank you. We'll take another one from in the room.
Hello. Dan Rivers from British broadcaster ITV News. I heard the word stigma mentioned several times, that you want to remove the stigma. Is your message to pilots and other people that this is no longer the preserve of cranks and that you won't be laughed at and that you will take them seriously? Is that the takeaway?
That is exactly the message. I mean, at NASA, we're scientists. We love data. We love all data. And if there is something that needs to be reported, and we want people to be able to feel that they can report that. We spoke in the open hearing that we had here just a few months ago. Dan, remind me when it was.
May 31st.
And we actually talked then about we wanted to remove the stigma, and we also did not tolerate any of the abuse that some of our members of the panel were receiving, particularly on social media, for doing this really important scientific study. So absolutely, we want pilots and both, as Bill said, you know, both private pilots, commercial pilots, military pilots, to feel that if they see something, they need to report it.
I want to say, and I want to repeat the way I said it, we want to shift the conversation about UAPs from sensationalism to science.
Yeah. I think of this in terms of the signs we see around for security, which say, if you see something, say something. Mm-hmm. I think in this context, we would summarize it as, if you see something, collect high-quality data on it, because then we can learn.
If I may, I just noticed in the report the GoFast incident was one that was picked out, and that had been held up as an example of a very credible sighting that you seem to be pouring doubt on. Can you just talk to that?
I mean, we looked at that as one example, and you know, I think this is something that Arrow has actually done a very good job of going through the events. And most events are going to turn out, even if there are some events that in the end turn out to be something novel, most events are going to turn out to be conventional things, balloons, airplanes, and so on. I think of the process of discovery of anomalies as looking for a needle in a haystack. And if you want to find a needle in a haystack, you've got two choices. Either you know exactly what the needle looks like and you design a very good filter to look for the needle. It's called match filtering in our in sort of AI work, machine learning, signal processing. Or you don't know what you're looking for. And with anomalies, that's really the case we're in. We're looking for things we don't understand. So if you want to find something strange in a haystack, you better know exactly what hay looks like. And you better be able to characterize that really well. And that's why in a process like this, and this is something that I think we bring to this as we look for anomalies, is you need to know what typical regular things look like under all conditions. You need to know what balloons look like when pilots see them, so under unusual conditions, so that you can eliminate those events. And that's why in identifying anomalies, understanding the normal is a very important part of it, and understanding that under different observing conditions and collecting data in a uniform way. I mean, this is what we do when we study anomalies in space science or other areas of science. And what we're trying to do is bring this approach to this field by saying collect high quality data, understand the normal events, and that's how we move things forward.
Thank you.
We'll move on to the next question, please.
Hello, I'm Nomia Iqbal from BBC News. Just to follow up on the stigma question, UAP, that term has been, you know, used in part to destigmatize UFOs. The fact is most people use UFOs. Most of the American public, most of the world use that term. So I wonder how much is the stigma still a problem for you, and what are you practically doing to about it, really, to convince people? And my second very quick question, in your report, I noticed that you said AI is a very essential tool for identifying rare occurrences. Yesterday, we were at this big AI summit where you had 100 senators meeting all the big tech tycoons, Elon Musk, Mark Zuckerberg. And you know, speaking to some senators afterwards, they said, we are concerned about AI. We need it to be regulated. Does that concern you? Are you worried that it might hamper your work? Thank you very much.
Well, two big questions. First of all, do I personally believe that AI needs to be have some boundaries? The answer to that for our existentialism, yes. Can you do that within the appropriate bounds so that, as I said in my remarks, that we're going to utilize AI as one of the tools as we search for what is an answer to the UAP. And so no, I don't think that any attempts to, that the Congress has underway to try to write a law that would appropriately put guardrails around AI for other reasons is in any way going to inhibit us from utilizing the tools of AI to help us in our quest on this specific issue. Now, what was your other question?
Just how do you destigmatize the whole thing? Because I know you call it UAPs, but you know, people don't refer it to it in that way.
Yeah. Well, you know, there's a mindset. We all are entertained by Indiana Jones in the Amazon and finding the crystal skull. So there's a lot of folklore out there. That's why we entered the stage the arena to try to get into this from a science point.
I think you can blame the X-Files for a loss of this as well.
That possibly too, but just remember what I said. We NASA are trying to shift it from sensationalism to science.
Thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am.
And we do have a long line in the room, but I want to give a couple chances to some people on the phone line. So I'm going to go to the phone for our first question there. Please do introduce yourself and ask your question. The phone, can you hear me?
Our first question is from Marcia Dunn with the Associated Press. Your line is open.
Yes, hi, Marcia Dunn, AP. I'm already receiving emails on Area 51 in Roswell, so I would like to ask Mr. Spergel, how much were you and your fellow panel members hassled or bombarded by this sort of thing during the course of your study? And for NASA, are you not naming the director of UAP research for this very reason, so that they're not hassled and bombarded by the fringe element? Thanks.
No, I would divide kind of emails and tweets into two types, right? There's some where people honestly are curious about things they've seen, they've heard, you know, there are things that are hard to respond to, like my uncle who's dead saw something strange, and you get a report. And you know, that's not useful, but that's harmless. On the other hand, one of the things that happened during the study, and this may be part of a bigger discussion of cultural behavior on social media, where people behave badly, and I would say harassed some of our panel members, and that I think was very inappropriate behavior one doesn't want to see. Sadly, I think it's part of a deeper problem when people somehow feel on the web, on social media, they can be nasty and hostile, and sadly, some of our panel members experience that.
Yeah, I would just simply add to that to say that not only were some of the things that our panel members received during the course of this study simple trolling, some of them actually rose to actual threats. And as a result, you know, we at NASA take, you know, the sanctity of the scientific process and the security and safety of our team extremely seriously. And yes, that's in part why we are not splashing the name of our new director out there, because science needs to be free. Science needs to undergo a real and rigorous and rational process, and you need the freedom of thought to be able to do that. Some of the threats and the harassment have been beyond the pale, quite frankly, towards some of our panelists. And yes, it's important that science be free as part of that process.
Thank you so much. We will go to another question on the phone, please. Please go ahead and introduce yourself.
Our next question comes from Tom Clark with Sky News London. Your line is open.
Oh, hi there. Thank you very much for taking my question. I want to understand whether and how much, you won't give us an idea of money, but how many assets or new research programs will be devoted to this by the administration? Because it strikes me that although the argument for aviation safety is clear, there are other departments and agencies responsible for that particular thing. And as the report concludes, the likelihood of there being extraterrestrial explanations or truly scientific explanations for many of these phenomena is very, very small. Shouldn't NASA devote its research budgets and its efforts to those much more likely and tangible signs of extraterrestrial life through things like the James Webb Space Telescope or extrasolar planet detection?
Thank you for the question. So obviously we don't discuss budget openly, but we are committed to supporting the whole of government study into UAP. All of our data are open. In fact, if you look at the report, you'll see a very large sort of back background material or supplemental material in there, because we literally released everything because that's what we do at NASA. We do have our key agency goals. We have obviously our goals in the Science Mission Directorate, our themes that we follow, and one of those, as the administrator described, is the search for life elsewhere. And we do that, and he described the research beautifully. I think he may be going for my job, actually, but he described the research so well that what we need to find is a rocky planet around a hospitable star that isn't too violent, that is in just that right place, that has signatures of water and signatures of carbon, so the building blocks of life. And we continue to strive to do that. We do that with the James Webb Telescope. We'll be doing that when we launch the Nancy Grace Roman Telescope that even has a coronagraph around it to block out the light of the neighboring stars and really let us look at those possible planets. And then beyond that, the next big telescope recommended by the Astrophysics Decadal is the Habitable Worlds Observatory, actually a mission designed to look for hospitable and find like Earth 2.0 in another stellar system. And so they really are in the forefront of our goals at NASA. So thanks so much for the question.
I'm going to ask...
Just jump in to clarify something. Will you be devoting any new resource or research projects to this particular aim then, given that's where the interesting questions really are? Should NASA spend time and budget pursuing the much less likely task of finding signs of extraterrestrial life in small objects within or close to the Earth's atmosphere?
So, I mean, most of our, obviously our instruments are designed to look for the phenomena that we study at NASA. If any of our data are useful, if any of our data are applicable, then we absolutely will be devoting that and turning that over through our liaison to the whole of government approach. We are not at this time intending to design a mission to do this. That is not part of our kind of overarching NASA direction. We are looking at providing some research support. So if somebody wants to write a research proposal, send it in through the regular channels. We will be looking for ways to do that. And we also talked about supporting sort of the citizen science and the broader repository of data. Dan, do you want to add to that?
NASA's data are free and publicly accessible for the entire world to download. And we pride ourselves on that fact. And it's this openness of data and our approach, which is why we're all here today. To answer your specific question about devoting research budgets to the potentially truly interesting ones, well, I think, as David said, you have to understand the chaff in order to really understand and pinpoint the potentially interesting ones, okay? So we are in such a data-poor regime at the moment that we need to turn it into a data-rich one to do that. And we employ NASA's assets, many other partners' assets as well in that quest.
And if your question suggests, and I do not know that it does, but if it suggests that NASA ought to keep its nose out of this, well, let me tell you, NASA is not a place that's going to hide its head in the sand. Now, is there interest in this phenomenon in other agencies? In my previous life in the Senate, I was privy to talk to the Navy pilots and to see the video of what they encountered off the coast of California in 2004. That was in a classified setting then. But this is now, and you have now seen that video, and you have heard from those former Navy pilots. Is that of a concern to the Department of Defense? Of course it is. Therefore, we're going to continue our search from a scientific point of view. It's going to be, if those other agencies continued their search, we're going to be glad to join in with them. But our stuff is going to be open.
Great. I'm going to take one more from the phone before we go back to the floor. We have a lot of questions. I'm going to hope we can stick to sort of one per person and see how many we can get through. So one more from the phone, please.
Our next question comes from Jeff Faust with Space News. Your line is open.
Hi. I know the press release states that NASA is still evaluating the independent study team's report and its recommendations. Does NASA plan to publish a formal response to the report and its recommendations? And if so, what timeline can we expect to see that?
So let me give you a quick preview about how this works. So we have only very, very recently received the report, and what you have seen today in our press release represents our initial actions in recognition of the urgency of this matter. And yes, we will be following up as appropriate with additional actions, but of course we need additional time to fully ingest the recommendations and act on them in light of budget and many other priorities. But we'll be announcing more in the future.
Great, thank you. Please, back to the room. Identify yourself too, please.
Good morning, Sam Cabral with BBC News Digital. We've been talking a lot about shift from sensationalism to science today. Has NASA been in touch with the Mexican authorities about the rather sensational revelations earlier this week of two allegedly non-human corpses? And what, if any, importance do you attach to these discoveries?
I think David had a prep for that one.
Well, this is something that I know I've only seen on Twitter, so it's, when we have unusual things, you want to make data public. I think of this as like NASA has one of the most valuable samples from outer space, lunar rocks. What do? We make them available to any scientists who want to work on this. We don't know the nature of those samples that were shown in front of them. If I was the Mexican government, I would making recommendations to the Mexican government. That's not our charge here. We're doing this for NASA. My recommendation was, if you have something strange, make samples available to the world scientific community, and we'll see what's there.
I'll just add that one of the main goals of what we're trying to do here today is to move conjecture and conspiracy towards science and sanity, and you do that with data, as David says. And that's the whole purpose of this study and this roadmap.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Brandy Vincent from Dip and Scoop. Thank you all for doing this. I actually have two lines of questions, if it's okay. First, for Ms. Fox, what's the timeline and immediate actions that NASA is pursuing specifically with Aero now that the report has been completed? And what mechanisms are NASA and DOD really using to share information and collaborate securely? And do you see more coming? And then separately, for Mr. Spergel, I noticed in the final report a lot of the images and media that were added were from DOD, snapshots that we'd previously seen from DOD data. Not much from FAA, if anything, not from other agencies. Can you speak to why that is and what all you used beyond DOD to inform your report?
Dr. Fox, Dr. Spergel, I'll pass it to you guys.
Sure. So. Yes, our immediate actions, I think there was such a lot in those questions. So the immediate actions, we've established our director of UAP research. They're working across the whole of government. They're working very closely with Arrow. They are the sort of central point for all of the collaboration. I'm not sure what else you asked, I'm sorry.
What mechanisms are you using to share data and information with the Defense Department?
All mechanisms available to us. As Dan eloquently said, all of our data are open and public. So actually, we share everything with everybody. So everybody can access our NASA data.
I mean, do you have like a specific repository or mechanism or channel specifically with DOD where you're sharing information? Can you just expand a little on how Aero and DOD are working? So Aero and NASA are working so deeply to share things.
Sure, do you want to take that?
Yeah, sure, I'm happy to handle that. Yeah. So as Nikki beautifully said, all of NASA's data is open and accessible to the public. If DOD on a specific instance need to tap our expertise, then there are obviously secure ways of doing that, and we've done that by appointing our liaison officer. And yes, we know how to talk to DOD in a classified space. But again, most of what we do is unclassified, and for good reason.
And the answer is actually straightforward, that Arrow is the lead agency in the government. So FAA-reported events go to Arrow. Mm-hmm. So they're the central collection agency, and that actually, if you go to the Arrow site, they have a pretty complete list of things they've analyzed and are trying to make public. Though with Arrow, and this is just something I think is worth repeating in the context of looking at images that come from military satellites and intelligence community, it's important to remember that things are images taken by military instruments are classified, not because of what's in the image, but because of the nature of the measuring instrument. And I think this is one of the unique things that NASA brings here, is NASA is about openness and transparency. When NASA makes measurements, NASA has across all of it does, this program of making its data open and available. And of course, because it's not making measurements with classified instruments, that enables it to do this. And that one of the things that NASA brings to this space.
Thank you. And just a really quick clarification, because I think it's important. The NASA Aero liaison, is that official the same as your new UAP head of research?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. One more in the room before we go back to the phones for a couple.
Thank you. My name is Jacob Jensen. I work for a Danish newspaper called Berlinski. My question is for Mr. Nelson. You said at the beginning of the meeting that that NASA will be transparent. Well, a month and a half ago, Mr. David Grush said under oath in Congress that the US government is in possession of UAPs and extraterrestrial life. How can you be sure at NASA that other parts of the US government is being transparent?
I don't speak for other parts of the government, but I can tell you NASA, which I speak for, is open and transparent with our data.
Do you believe what Mr. David Grush said, or is he lying?
You would want me to give a personal opinion?
Yes, please.
Of what he said. What he said, if I recall having seen this on the nightly news, was that he had a friend that knew where a warehouse was that had an UFO locked up in a warehouse. He also said he had another friend that said that he had parts of an alien. Whatever he said, where's the evidence? Response.
Excuse me. He also said that he did interview over 40 employees at the Pentagon.
A long time ago, there was a TV show, Jack Friday, and he used to say, just the facts, just the facts. Show me the evidence.
Thank you, sir.
All right, we will go to the phones. Again, I know people have lots of questions, but I'm going to try to keep us to just to one for each person. And so next person on the phone, go ahead and introduce yourself.
The next question comes from Gina Cesari with ABC News. Your line is open.
This is for Senator Nelson. Your report mentioned that AI could be very useful in helping in this investigation. How do you see that, sir?
Well, why limit us in anything in interpretation of data? And AI is just coming on the scene to be explored in all areas. So why should we limit any technological tool in analyzing data that we have? I said AI was one of the things that we were going to employ.
We use AI or artificial intelligence and machine learning throughout our NASA science portfolio. It is an amazing tool for helping us to actually find often signatures that are sort of buried in data. And so a lot of our data are just sort of wiggly line plots. We get excited about wiggly line plots, by the way. But sometimes you see the wiggles and you miss a signal in there. And by using artificial intelligence, we can often find signatures. So one example we've had is to be able to find signatures of superstorms using very old data that really is before sort of like routine scientific satellite data. And it's amazing. And so just being able to use those techniques often can allow us to find things, to actually find the needle. As David so eloquently said, once you've actually really, it also helps us to really characterize the hay. And so you can start subtracting the hay and look for the needles behind.
So let me just take this moment to say, to try to demystify AI and ML.
Thank you.
When, as scientists, and probably many of you in high school were trained to do this, we had some data. You took your data, you drew a graph, you put a line through it. You had data in two dimensions, X and Y. Right now, much of our data is in a much higher dimensional space. And if you're working with something like ChatGPT, it's in the a high dimensional space of language, or tokens, if you want to get technical, with 12,000 tokens in the ChatGPT 3.5, for example. And machine learning is a powerful tool for representing functions in high-dimensional space. That means we get to work with data in a high-dimensional space. AI is very powerful, but it's no more powerful than the data you give it. It's a way of, this is why it's very powerful, say, with NASA's weather and climate data. We've got an incredible amount of data, and it's data that you want to do more with than just put a line on a graph. You want to extract all that information or more information in that high dimensional space. And I think we're just really discovering the power of that tool. And it's one of the tools NASA and not just scientists, but I think a lot of people in a lot of different industries are using to learn new things about high dimensional data. But it always comes back to the data you feed into your analysis, whether it's a line on a graph paper or a high dimensional space explored with machine learning. And if you don't got good data, you're not going to learn things.
I'm going to add one sentence. Sorry. High dimensional does not mean high space dimensions, not interdimensional travel. We're talking about multiple parameters here. Okay.
Right. Great. We are coming close to time. I want to get two more questions in. We're going to do one on the phone and one more in the room. And hopefully if we keep our questions short and our answers short, we'll get to those two. For anybody who's here who hasn't had a chance to ask a question, you are more than welcome to send an email, and we will try to get you questions as answers as quickly as possible. So one more on the phone, please.
Yes, our next question comes from Peggy Hollinger with Financial Times. Your line is open.
Thank you very much, and thank you for allowing me to ask a question. I'm curious about you saying here that you want to rope in crowdsourcing, but also you speak specifically about the potential of using commercial assets as well as your own. And I'm curious about, can you just give me a bit more detail how you will do that? Will that be through commercial contracts, or will you ask for voluntary reportings of sightings? And also, I think that's when you talk a lot about the importance of sensor, I'm going to use the word harmonization, because there's no kind of harmonization between the way the sensors work. Presumably, that would be the same for this use of commercial assets. How does that use of commercial assets and crowdsourcing square with the sensor harmonization that you talk about? And who's going to pay for all this? Thank you.
So let me just say a little bit about crowdsourcing. Much of what we have in mind is taking advantage of the fact that there are several billion of these floating around, right? And they take, I'm holding up a cell phone for those on the radio. They take wonderful, high quality images, have high quality metadata, record local magnetic field, sound, gravitational field. There's a wealth of data that a cell phone takes, and you can imagine designing apps that make the images relatively tamper-free. You can at least make it hard to do. And I think if we have a collection where interesting events are collected by citizens, hosted and you have multiple images of the same event, we will be able to learn a lot. And, you know, one of the things NASA supports is citizen science. And I think that the idea that if you see something you don't understand, collect data, we aggregate the data and we learn from it, is important in this context, and just, I think, in some ways, an opportunity to engage the broader public in doing science.
Great. Our last question, please, from the floor.
Yep. Thank you all for doing this. Joe Khalil with News Nation. My first question is, you've described harassment of some of the panelists. While that is horrible and never a good thing, it does sort of come with the nature of public officials. You know, Mr. Nelson, as senator, lawmakers get that kind of thing all the time. Is that the justification for keeping this new position, director of UAP research, private? Do you plan on doing that forever? Is that a temporary thing? Because it seems to cut against the dedication to being open and transparent if this person forever is not going to be revealed, their identity, who they are.
Yeah, okay, so at the time, yes, we're withholding that name. Let's not forget that we've only just received this report. And what we need to do now as an agency is come together and provide a cohesive and coherent response to it that addresses multiple findings and recommendations, okay? We're only announcing initial actions today. Will that person's name be disclosed to answer your specific question? Potentially, yes. But again, we need to ensure that the scientific process and method is free, okay? That's my response.
Thank you. And just lastly, the report says that you relied on unclassified material. You've given a very understandable description for why the DOD classifies certain images and videos. Why did you all not have access to classified material, and could you have, you know, done that?
I have. So just understand that. Let the committee speak for themselves.
So one of the reasons that we restricted ourselves this study to unclassified data is because we can speak openly about it. And in so doing, we're aiming, again, to alter the discourse from sensationalism to science, as Administrator Nelson beautifully said. NASA personnel, as appropriate, know how to talk to DOD on a classified basis, but the purpose of this study was to tell us what open data we could use in combination with the power of science to move our understanding forward. Okay? That was the purpose, and we're speaking about it openly today.
And so one of the challenges
And I'm afraid we do have to wrap up. We are at time. So thank you, everybody, for being here today. Again, for those people who were not able to get questions, I do apologize for not doing it in the room. However, please send an email based on our press release. You will have information to access, and we will try to get you the answers we can. And with that, we are concluding today's press briefing, and thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
It's a new era of pioneers, star sailors, thinkers, and adventurers.
3, 2, 1, 0, all engine running.
Let's go.
We have been given the scientific knowledge, the technical ability, and the material to pursue the exploration of the universe.
Specialist.
I'm Victor Glover. I'm the pilot.
I'm Reed Wiseman. I'm the commander for the Artemis II mission to the moon.
To the moon.
To the moon.
To the moon.
When I was young, I had a poster of the Earthrise picture, the famous picture that was taken on Apollo 8. And the fact that it was a human behind the lens that made that picture so profound and changed how we all thought of our own home was so amazing to me. The moon is not just a symbol of thinking about our place in the universe. It's not just a symbol of exploration. It's actually a beacon for science. It's a beacon for understanding where we came from.
You know, pushing ourselves to explore is just core to who we are. It's a part of being a human. That's our nature. We go out there and we explore to learn about where we are, why we are, understanding the big questions about our place in the universe. The exploration we're doing is the first few steps on the path of getting humans to Mars.
The Artemis campaign and missions have set such an ambitious goal for humanity that it's inspiring contributions from around the globe. Not just one nation is inspired and moved by this, but nations from around the globe are coming together.
When I look at the Artemis II crew with Victor, Christina, and Jeremy, they want to go do this mission. They are keenly driven. They are humble to a fault. It is so cool to be around them. Artemis II is a huge mission, but I hope we will look back and realize that this was one tiny step in humans on Mars and a sustained presence on our moon.
Four-stage engine start.
Artemis II will be NASA's first crewed flight test of the Space Launch System rocket
and Orion spacecraft around the moon.
To verify today's capabilities for humans to explore deep space
and pave the way for NASA's long-term human and scientific presence
on the lunar surface.
We are ready.
We are going
to the moon
for all humanity.
We are Artemis.
We are going. The history of this agency is marked with broken barriers, once viewed as impossible, with science fiction turned reality, with innovations that have spun industries all their own, and with demonstrations of peace for all humankind.
We soar in the skies of our home planet. We maintain a human presence just outside of gravity, and we touch points all across the solar system and beyond. We're going back to the moon, and this is why.
The moon is a treasure trove of science.
It holds opportunities for us to make discoveries about our home planet, about our sun,
and about our solar system.
The wealth of knowledge to be gleaned from the moon will inspire a new generation of thought and action.
Without fail, every major program and mission NASA has invested in has led to technologies and capabilities that have shaped our culture.
The breakthroughs of the Artemis era will define our generation and the generations to follow.
The tens of thousands of jobs associated with propelling us to the moon today are just the beginning of a lunar economy that will see hundreds of thousands of new jobs develop around the world.
This is not an ambition of one entity or one country. The exploration of the moon is a shared effort.
Woven together by a desire for the greater good.
Why the moon? Because the missions of tomorrow will be sparked by the accomplishments of the Artemis generation today.
Because the ambition to go has already begun.
And because Mars is calling. We need to learn what it takes to establish a community on another cosmic shore. So let's camp close before pushing out.
And so, we go to the moon now, not as a series of isolated missions, but to build a community on and around the moon capable of proving how to live on other worlds.
We'll use the lessons from more than 50 years of peaceful exploration to send a new generation to the lunar surface to stay.
We will anchor our efforts on the lunar South Pole to establish the Artemis Base Camp,
positioning us for long-term science and exploration of the lunar surface.
We will prove what it takes to assemble a complex ship in deep space.
We will perfect descending down to and returning from a distant surface.
We will learn how humans can survive and thrive in a partial gravity environment.
With improved spacesuit designs, mobile habitats, and with reconnaissance robots pre-positioning and relocating supplies.
We will learn how to utilize the resources we find on these other worlds, starting with finding water ice and purifying it to drinkable water.
And refining that into hydrogen for fuel and oxygen to breathe.
We will establish fission power plants on the surface of the moon, capable of supporting a growing community of efforts.
And we will expand the logistics supply chain
to enable commercial and international partners
to resupply and refuel deep space outposts.
None of this is simple or easy, but nothing in our history ever has been.
The Eagle has landed. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
This kind of continuous lunar presence is a natural extension of all that we've learned in low Earth orbit. And what we will accomplish there will ensure the monumental missions to Mars are within reach. As we ready the launch of the first Artemis mission, and as commercial companies ready their lunar landers for the first private payload deliveries, we have already begun to take the next step.
Let us continue to dream the impossible dream that now becomes real.
Space is for everyone.
We humans really are connected to the universe.
The Earth's climate is changing. We have documented the changes.
And we have touchdown!
And liftoff. Starliner is headed back to space on the shoulders of Atlas.
Artemis generation stands ready, ready to return humanity to the moon and then to take us further than ever before to Mars.
Through Artemis, the twin sister of Apollo, we are returning to the moon. This is Orion, the only human-rated spacecraft in the world capable of deep space travel. Now, the Space Launch System, NASA's most powerful rocket since the Apollo era, stands ready. Having undergone and passed numerous tests, the time has come to complete the journey. With hardware originating from every state in the nation and from partners around the world, Artemis 1 will be the first flight test of each of these components now assembled together. These two solid rocket boosters will provide more than 75% of the thrust necessary to leave Earth. Each booster stands 17 stories tall, a full segment more powerful than the SRBs of Shuttle. Together, these boosters are capable of 7.2 million pounds of thrust and will burn for the first 2 minutes of flight. The core stage, at 212 feet, is the tallest rocket stage NASA has ever built. With the rocket's flight computer secured inside, the core stage is designed to hold 2.3 million pounds of fuel. The 196,000 gallons of liquid oxygen and the 537,000 gallons of liquid hydrogen will combine to provide 8.5 minutes of propellant to the four massive RS-25 engines mounted below. as proven workhorses of the shuttle fleet, each RS-25 engine has a legacy all its own. Together, these four engines provide 2 million pounds of thrust, and with the SRBs, are capable of pushing Orion to a speed of 17,000 miles per hour. The interim cryogenic propulsion stage is a 45-foot tall upper stage that offers Orion nearly 25,000 pounds of thrust. Performing two separate burns, the ICPS will first raise Orion's orbit and then, later, propel it out on a trajectory to the moon. The ICPS is powered by a single RL-10 engine that will perform these two burns. This storied engine has propelled robotic missions to every planet in the solar system, including Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, the first space probes to reach interstellar space. Orion's service module, provided by the European Space Agency, is the powerhouse that fuels and propels Orion in space. It stores the spacecraft's propulsion, thermal control, electrical power, and critical life support systems, such as water, oxygen, and nitrogen. Orion's crew module is the pressurized segment of the spacecraft, where future crews will live and work on journeys to the moon. Capable of accommodating four crew members for up to 21 days, this capsule includes state-of-the-art avionics, innovative crew systems, and the largest heat shield of its kind for entry back into the Earth's atmosphere. Positioned at the top of Orion is the launch abort system, designed to pull the crew to safety in the event of an emergency, on the pad or during launch. Three solid rocket motors can activate in milliseconds, accelerating from 0 to 500 miles per hour in 2 seconds to propel Orion and crew safely away from the rocket. Now fully assembled, Artemis 1 stands at 322 feet. Artemis is no longer a series of separate parts and programs. United together, this is the first of Artemis's arrows, capable of ushering in the next chapter of human lunar exploration. Only together, this mighty system represents all that is possible, all that we are capable of when united around a stunning vision, with each component playing its part in a grander effort. We, the people of NASA and our partners, we, the people of the Artemis generation all around this beautiful world, will bear witness to what we are capable of. Together, we are going back to the moon.
NASA is preparing for a journey back to the moon, and after that, we're setting our sights on Mars. To get there, we need tons of rocket power coming from our space launch system.
When it comes to how much power this thing can push out, this thing is massive.
It's going to be mesmerizing to stand next to this massive vehicle. The immensity of it, knowing that this thing